Good morning and welcome to worship at Bethel-St. Andrew's United Church. I'm the Reverend Dr. Christine Johnson, and I'm here with Rick Leben, and we're so happy to have you back, Rick.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to be
here. Yeah. Mike did a good job while you were gone,
but
it's wonderful to have you and to share and worship together.
Thank you.
Today is the sixth Sunday of Easter, and so we're still celebrating in many ways the resurrection. So let us listen for our call to worship. From the dormancy of winter comes the new life of spring. Brown clematis vines produce green shoots. The buds on the maple tree poke out, waiting to turn into leaves. Lilac bushes are getting ready to burst into purple. Ground gets turned over, showing earthworms doing their job. The branches of the apple tree show signs of future blossoms. The oak sapling, tiny and thin, bravely survives. The yellow dandelions display their flowers so the bees know where to go for nectar. Green grass starts its journey up through the hardness of the lawn. From the dormancy of winter comes the new life of spring. In the barn and pasture, the mother sheep give birth to lambs. The birds build their nests and lay their eggs. The caterpillars sleep until the chrysalis unfolds into butterflies. White and red trilliums carpet the forest. The spirea and the daffodils turn yellow. From the dormancy of winter comes the new life of spring. In these amazing transformations, we see the power of life reveal the glory of our Creator, our God, the one who is called the vine grower. And this vine grower is the one we worship today, the source of all that is beautiful and wise. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Let us pray. Gracious God, you teach us about the connections that hold us together, how Jesus is the vine and we are the branches. Help us to grow strong and produce fruit. Pour your living spirit into our daily lives so we also help others to flourish. Forgive us when we fail to abide in your love, causing our branches to wither and die. Forgive us when we cut off branches too soon and throw them in the fire. You are the source of life, and for that we are grateful. Inspire us to pay attention to the beauty of the earth and to praise your name in all we do. Amen. Our first hymn is a very familiar one. It's from Voices United 602, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds.
Thank you. each other's burdens bear, and often for each other flows the sympathizing tear. This glorious hope revives our courage on the way, that we shall live in perfect love in God's eternal day.
Our first reading is from the Epistle of John. And that is chapter 4, and beginning at verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this way, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. And then turning to the Gospel of John, chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. So ends our reading from the Gospel of John. Thanks be to God for God's holy word. Amen. At the heart of Jesus' teachings is the concept of connection. We are connected to Jesus, and Jesus is connected to God. We are connected to the teachings of wise men and women throughout the ages, and those connections are difficult to break. These are the ties that bind us into one human community. For some reason, we've been told the lie of the self-made man or woman. This idea that what we have is a result of our own labor is ridiculous. We are born into a world that has been forming and developing for thousands of years. To say that what I have is mine alone, and I'm perfectly within my rights to hoard wealth and to exploit labor, well, that idea is almost delusional. When we are born, we enjoy the fruit of the vines that someone else has tended, and it is often simply handed to us. If I was to do a deep history of the Johnson family farm, the farm where I grew up, literally located on the border between Chatham-Kent and Lambton counties in southwestern Ontario, and I'm using this as an example because it's what I know and where I grew up. If I was to do a deep history of this piece of land, I would discover that at one point in its evolution, it was covered by water. And this sea is what deposited over time a rich soil that is good for growing crops. No farmer landing on this soil could claim that he or she is responsible for it. It is given. And yes, it takes good stewardship to make sure you use the soil to the best of your ability, but to think that somehow you're the one who created this soil is false. At one point, strong, straight trees covered the land, incredible forests of hardwood. And over time, these fields were cleared, making way for larger fields and more production. My brother, who now owns these lands, has never had to clear cut forests. The fields that he tills are given. Jesus says, "I am the vine, and you are the branches." For thousands of years, this farm was part of a territory traversed by the First Peoples, who used all of its resources to have a rich and full life. When Europeans arrived in North America, they simply took what they wanted, and settlers came to colonize the land. Our farm is part of a gift given to a British soldier for his participation in defending the interests of Britain. In 1884, my great-grandfather purchased it from this soldier, and for 137 years, it's been in the Johnson family. These are the ties that bind us to the long history that brings us to today. And you could apply the same idea to any piece of land on which you live or which you own. It would be very interesting to see what that deep history is. Religion, which literally means the ties that bind, remind us of these connections so that we can temper our hubris. Hubris is excessive pride or self-confidence. When I look around the world, I see the hubris that is constantly getting us into trouble. Just this past week, I watched President Joe Biden give his 100-day speech to Congress. I thought that he said some very important things, but I was dismayed by one turn of speech. He kept saying, if we, which is the USA, if we want to win the 21st century, we need to do X, Y, or Z. And this phrase kept going over, if we want to win the 21st century, we have to compete against China. If we want to win the 21st century, so and so and so and so. This is hubris. The confidence that needs and expects winners and losers. This is triumphalism. When one country triumphs over others and gets rich on the back of its neighbors. Over time, it is necessary to remove the branches that bear no fruit. That's what Jesus says. But this pruning is done carefully so that more fruit can be produced. This is stewardship, the idea of taking care of the world you've been given. The opposite of this idea is entitlement. As a self-made man or woman, I take all the resources I can take and I turn them into money or power. To think that what you have is all of your own doing just doesn't make sense. We're born into a particular family and given the skills and talents we develop. In a country like Canada, if you are born in the year 2021, you are given roads and educational institutions. You are given health care and all the knowledge that has come before you. You are given things like the internet and smartphones and good food. You are given a democratic country that prides itself on the rule of law. You're given freedom of religion. You're given the freedom to speak any language that you would like. This concept of givenness is very important for us to understand in order for us to be truly thankful for what we have. And it's also important for us to understand that some people get a very poor start in life when they are born into poverty or abuse or born into war or born into a situation where there are natural disasters or born into minority groups that are exploited for free labor. We stand on the shoulders of many, many people who have built this land for the sake of the common good. And we also stand on the shoulders of all those people who have trampled over other people, who have taken the resources of the land without repairing it, who have poured carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, and who hoard wealth while some people in the world starve. These are the ties that bind, whether we want them to or not. This is the dilemma, and it's expressed in the Epistle of John. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. In this interconnected relational universe, the time has come to stop talking about winners and losers. If Jesus is the vine and we are the branches, then we need to abide in the love of God that's at the heart of all that we do. The other mistake we make is thinking we live in a world of scarcity. Meanwhile, we live in one of the richest countries in the world. Most of us live in nice, warm, dry houses, and we drive nice vehicles. And around my neighborhood, most people have expensive toys like snowmobiles, four-wheelers, boats, boat trailers, and big trucks to pull the big boats with their trailers. And then a lot of people have second homes, cottages that they enjoy. When I read the history of our churches, it's amazing how hard people worked to develop these parishes. In Fitzroy Harbor, it all started with a log cabin built as a community center for religious services and as a school. 1832. One of these first ministers to come and do services in this log cabin walked all the way from Richmond. That's because he had no horse and there were very few roads. His name was Reverend Andrew Glenn, and after only 2 years of enduring these difficulties of walking 45 kilometers each way, he died from pneumonia brought on by the wet, cold, and fatigue of these journeys. What hurts my heart, and this is not just in Fitzroy Harbor, but all over this country and the world, it hurts my heart to see wealthy communities starve their churches to such a degree that their ministry falters and dies. We were given these churches. Reverend Glenn died a young man for the sake of the gospel. How do we honor his legacy in 2021 and continue to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ? These are the ties that bind us to Scripture and to each other. Jesus also gave up his life so that we might know what true love really looks like. Yes, changes come and changes go. But our job is to maintain the vine so that it continues to bear fruit. This passage helps us to understand the importance of stewardship, of taking care of what has been given to us. The vines that don't produce fruit need to be pruned and thrown in the fire. But the vines that grow off of our Christian roots need to be carefully tended. See, yes, technically my brother owns the Johnson Farm now, but he doesn't really own the Johnson Farm, if you know what I mean. He is the caretaker until someone else takes it over. And we don't own our church. We are the caretakers until the next generation comes along. This great big spinning blue planet is our home, and we are its caretakers for the short time we live on it, and then we die. These are the ties that bind. We are the recipients of the greatest and most precious commodity on earth, life, created by the love of God. With these two gifts, life and love, we have everything we need. We have everything we need to promote the true harmony, true cooperation, and create vibrant communities. With God as the vine grower, with God as the farmer, our fruitful, faithful lives are the greatest harvest of all. Amen.
Little old lady and her man, hand in hand on a park bench sat. Bands of gold, their fingers cold, even 60 years ago. With loving eyes he looked at her, just like he did in years before. She would smile and lift her head and touch his cheek and say, "My hair once gold has turned to snow. My hands are not as they once were. But in my heart, the love I share for you, my dear, is there. The love you've given to me lasts through times of good and times of bad, of hope and dreams that long have passed. My love is still for you." His arm he placed around her waist and kissed her on her cheek embraced. A tiny tear fell from his face as he said, "I love you, dear." The cold wind blew and up they stood. Hand in hand they slowly moved along the path that brought them to the place where they first met. A little old lady and her man, hand in hand on the park bench sat. Bands of gold their fingers hold, given 60 years ago.
Thank you, Rick. It just reminds me of the truth that when you bind yourself to someone like that, so many amazing things can happen.
Absolutely.
You know, the ties that bind us to our family and all of those things. And just, it's so important to remember them. 'Cause,
I agree.
Yeah. We are thankful, too, for everything that happens around the church, and we're thankful for the vaccines that seem to be ramping up, and we're thankful for everybody who continues to support the church. And I just wanted to say, the stewards felt that it was a good time to start to do the repair project on our front door. And so they're in the middle of getting all those plans made. And we are doing a special appeal to people that if you would consider an extra contribution to the church for the door project, it would be greatly appreciated. And any of those givings can be given either to our treasurer, Rob Rosler, or to the chair of stewards, who is Dave Haley. So thank you so much for your support. Let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the power of love that binds us together. And we're thankful that this love informs how we treat other people around us and how we live out our faith on a day-to-day level. Oh God, we know the source of this love, and it is you. And we know the source of goodness, and it is you. Help us to always abide in this love, to be brave, and to do the things that sometimes are difficult, but that we do when we truly believe in loving each other as ourselves. Help us to see our sisters and brothers as equals. And help us to work toward creating a community that is fair to everyone. Oh God, we pray for all of our governmental agencies that are working so hard around us to try to find solutions to this pandemic that we are experiencing. We pray for wisdom and knowledge, for compassion and understanding. And we pray that we, as citizens of this area, can remain diligent and careful as we try to make a way through this virus to try to reduce harm as much as we possibly can. Help us to stay strong and to be patient, to guard against getting frustrated, and to look out at the beauty of the world, the beauty of this spring, and to be grateful for everything we have. You have given us so much. You've given us our spouses and our families, our children, our parents, our brothers and sisters, our friends, all of these connections that mean so much to us. Help us to cherish them. Oh God, we pray for our community. We pray for our congregation. We pray for those among us who are dealing with serious health issues. In particular, we pray for Bob Pekarchuk. We pray for Debbie McIver. For Bruce Williams. We pray for Elsa Jensen. Surround them with your healing power. And give them peace and energy. Give them calm. And help them along their journey of life. Oh God, we thank you for the songs that we sing and for the scripture that we read. We thank you for the vine that sustains us each and every day. And we thank you, oh God, for being the vine grower, for being the farmer, tending to us every second of life. For this, we praise your name. We are so grateful. We say all this and we pray all this as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
To celebrate that love, we're going to join together in Voices United 333, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. The vine grower, our divine creator, is the one who loves us into being, who helps us move from dormancy to spring. Jesus is the vine, and we are the branches, all tied together in this one earthly community. We are the ties that bind our hearts in Christian love. And now, may that love of God, the peace of Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.